Redlands. I'm your host, Rodney Arbona, and I am here today with the legendary Gerald Albright. How are you, Gerald?
Fine, Rodney. How are you today?
I'm doing great. Once again, Gerald, thanks so much for being here. For people who don't know, we've had some hurdles to get to where we are together, but all in good fun, right, Gerald?
Absolutely. You know, we're not second to any level of tenacity at all. We made it happen. I'm glad about it.
We sure did. Our persistence paid off.
For sure.
You know, Gerald, I just want to let the audience know it's such an honor to spend this time with you. I've been listening to music for so many years. And the one thing that I find is so unique with you, as times have changed, you've always made the best of it. And you're so, the way you're able to go from, as you know, I appreciate your romantic music, because we've had that chat, and your music that's energizing and everything in between. It's a feat that is very few and far between.
Well, thank you for saying so. You know, music is my passion, and it's the one thing that allows me to just convey a positive message to my listening audience. And almost 19 records in now, I'm glad to have had that mission to bring the best music that I could possible the audience. So thank you for saying that, Rodney.
You're welcome. And just to get everybody a chance to get to know who Gerald is, because I have to just say also, when we first met, you were busy doing a whole lot of things, and it was just so, you're just such a regular guy. And the minute I got to in front of you, I felt like I already knew you for so many years. You knew nothing of me, but you know, we just like clicked 1, 2, 3, had such a cool conversation. And it was just such a pleasure to do so and get people to know you on that level.
Well, thank you. It's wonderful when it happens that way. And like you said, I am just a regular guy. I just love to have fun. Love meeting great people like yourself. And I think that's what is the theme for life, you know, is just finding the optimum level in life and meeting the great people that you're blessed to meet. And with my vocation, I get to travel a lot, and so I've met a lot of incredible people during my career, and so thank you for saying that. Yeah, I just regular Gerald, just Gerald.
That you are. And Gerald, let's just get everybody a little bit deeper with what's happening. In your life, you started out actually playing bass guitar, I believe?
Well, my first instrument was piano.
Piano, that's right.
Yeah, back in the early days when I was about 8 years old. And you know how your parents want you to learn some type of instrument, and usually there's a piano or some type of keyboard in the house. And we had this old upright piano, and my mom and dad thought it was a good idea to have the choir director of my church that I grew up in, who also moonlighted as a private teacher, teach me piano. And so at that age, it was an instrument that I truly hated. I didn't like it. I'll be honest, I did not like it. You know, it kept me away from, you know, playing outside with my friends in the neighborhood, and
sure,
and practicing scales and stuff was just the most boring thing.
Yes.
So about half a dozen lessons in, my private teacher George Turpo, God rest his soul, spoke to my parents and said, you know, we need to put Gerald on a different instrument. He's not feeling this piano. And he had this old alto saxophone in his garage that he hadn't played for years. And unannounced, he brought it to the next lesson. And I kind of, you know, frowned and said, well, Mr. Turbo, what's going on? We're going to do something different today. And he opened up this old case. And I remember it was an old black case with purple velvet.
Sure.
You know, those old school cases.
Yes, man. I remember them in band.
Yeah. And you could smell the history in the velvet. Know that whole thing. So
yes,
but we put it together, and then I made my first squeak, and I've been squeaking ever since.
Well, I don't know about squeaking, my friend. You're just Mr. Smooth on the sax.
I appreciate that.
Oh, that's great. So as we're playing saxophone at that young age, and you're going through school, did you continue loving it as much as we love listening to you at this point, or was it more of a love affair that needed some progression?
Well, I was instantly gravitated towards it, because at the age of 8 or 9 years old, you know, you can blow through this thing, you can press the keys. It was like a toy to me.
Sure.
You know, and I can make a sound at the same time. And so it was more interesting than piano. And even in elementary school, I was part of the concert band. I mean, I started really early in terms
of
working with different ensembles. And it was fortunate that we had a good music program at Compton Avenue Elementary School in the hood in South Central LA. And it just kind of snowballed from there, you know, through junior high school and high school and college. I just developed more and more of a love for it. And then now I'm meeting other saxophonists who now it's all about competition. Who's going to be first chair? Going to be first chair in the concert band. So now I'm really into it and trying to, you know, be my personal best.
You know, I remember those days trying to hold the first chair down.
Oh, yeah. Yeah,
band, jazz band, orchestra, oh boy, it's hard work.
There's a new girl.
at some point in band, we threw almost as many as elbows as we did in basketball, because that first jam was only one.
Exactly. Exactly. A lot of bumps and bruises along the way.
That's right. And speaking of bumps and bruises, your career has taken you everywhere around the world. And it's, how do you keep it together? Well, I know we had a short conversation before we went on, and now that we're talking about bumps and bruises, it might be a good time to filter right into that. But I applaud you on it, because you just keep such a great persona. Every time I see you, from other people interviewing you, and your music in itself just has such great expression at all times.
Well, thank you, Roddy. I tell you, man, I am the luckiest guy on the planet. I mean, I did go through the ranks. I went through what they called back in the day the Chitlin' Circuit, you know, the small clubs, you know,
right.
Blues Titan, and, you know, working for peanuts, and sometimes there were no peanuts. we worked for free, you know. And
right.
But I consider myself so lucky, because after all these years, I still have a vocation that I truly love. I can't really call it a job. It's more of a mission, and it's more of a blessing that I've been given, this talent that I've been given, that I can spread all over the globe and look out over the audience and see smiling faces coming back at me. I mean, that is, to me, the greatest compliment that one could have for somebody for literally multiple decades to follow your music and just keep that perpetual interest in your career and dress up and pay money to come out to see you perform, and all. It's just the greatest compliment in the world. So I'm a happy camper.
That's great. And just to name a few, because we'll get into the other few in a little bit, but not in the beginning, but some years back, people like Anita Baker, Ray Parker, Olivia Newton-John, The Temptations, I mean, playing for the president. This is, I can go on and on and on, but we're just talking, you know, in those years in itself, it's just amazing to have that opportunity, like you said, just meeting people at all levels.
It really is. And sometimes I have to pinch myself, you know. I mean, I can go inside my iPhone and call up folks like John Legend to say, hey, man, how you doing today?
Right.
Or you know, just people of iconic people, you know. But to me, they're just part of our fraternity.
And, you know, yes.
They're just neighbors. They're just friends, you know, but very talented friends and geniuses at their craft. So it's a beautiful thing to have that type of facility. And I have to say that I worked very hard, and I still work hard because of the passion that I have within the music. And you expressed early on, you asked about, you know, how do I do it? It's really, I always say that I play for free. I get paid for the travel. So, once I get on stage, that's our musical playground. And but it's just getting to the gig. That's where the word comes in. And you know, I just feel very balanced and very happy. You know, I just turned 60 this year, and I've
God bless.
30. Yeah, you know, it's a blessing, man. So I cannot complain whatsoever on any level.
Well, I'm going to say one thing. You don't look 60. I think you look younger now, because I've watched you for so many years. I don't know what it is, but you definitely, that definition of getting better like a fine wine.
But thank you, buddy. I appreciate that. You know, I think a lot of that is having a wife that cooks the healthy stuff. And she
yes,
watches me.
We've talked about that.
Yeah, you know, she does the real deal, man. It keeps me balanced. And she's literally the rock of the family and kind of keeps everybody in check, man. So the person that you see on the screen now, man, it's a derivative of her fine work, you know.
Oh, that's beautiful.
Yeah.
That's beautiful. Well, speaking of family, if you allow me, I've had the absolute pleasure. At this point, I feel like family. I got a chance to talk to the wife. I've had a chance of actually interviewing Selena as well. And speaking with her on a handful of opportunities. And what a pleasure to meet her. And I have to say, she is just an amazing talent. You can tell the apple doesn't fall far from the tree. And her talent in itself deserves all the credit she's getting. You must be very proud, the two of you.
Very, very proud. And I am blessed to, as her dad, to have the front row seat from when she was born to see this whole evolution of Selena. a young lady at, let's say, 8 or 9 years old, walking around the house singing Ella Fitzgerald and Whitney Houston.
Yes.
And Mariah Carey, and singing it correctly and in tune with all the inflections. And I'm like, this girl can sing. So
yes.
On my 1998 project called Live to Love, that was her first experience in doing an official recording session. And she did background vocals on probably 5 tunes on that particular project. And she was, at that time, a very young-sounding Selena, but at the same time, very professional and sung in tune. She knew how to stack and layer her tracks and match her inflection from track to track. And it was fascinating to watch. And to see her now just in just flourishing totally now as a wonderful artist on the global sense, it's just, you know, as a dad, I just beam, you know. And when we share the stage together, it sometimes is very difficult to fight back the tears.
is a beautiful thing, and I love the fact that you have such a beautiful family. I think it's a great example you're setting for us as a country to look at the Albrights and the challenge that you have with traveling, because you're not the only family who people have to travel. There's a lot of professions that do. But I think it's so beautiful how you and Glynis and kept it together and supported each other and have such a beautiful family in Selena, and of course your son as well. It's such a great thing to see that this can be real for everybody else. So great example to share with us.
Well, thank you for saying so. And I'm reminded every day, especially presently, that everything that's going on in the world today, when you bring it down to its rawest form, all we have is family and friends, you know, and the love for one another. All the stuff that happens outside of that is going to happen regardless. But you got to have that strong family base for, you know, that particular unit to say, okay, we're going through a chapter now. We all have to hold each other up. We all have to endure whatever this scenario is, whatever this chapter is, and get from point A to point B. And that's what we've tried to do as a family. And I'm just so proud of it. I look at the other three faces in the family, the immediate family, and I'm just so proud of where we are today, you know?
Yes.
Because it could have turned, I mean, we hear all the stories.
Sure.
We've seen the Jerry Springer shows. And the you know how it goes, man.
When do you have time to watch Jerry Springer?
Not a lot. But I tune in every now and then. And you know, you just see that it could be a total 180. It could be a total opposite of that. So that just validates to me that we're on the right road. And so I thank you for your wonderful words on that family tip. Thanks, bro.
Oh, you're welcome. It's my pleasure. Also, going back to 1998, Pleasures of the Night with Will Downing hit number one. That's a pleasure. That's a great song.
Yes, thank you. Will and I have quite a history. We started back in the 1990s with a tour called the Rhythm of Love Tour, which seemed like it was so popular, it seemed like it would never end.
Uh-huh.
And we probably did maybe 3 or 4 years of that with different artists like Rochelle Farrell and Jonathan Butler and Vesta Williams and Shantae Moore and Phil Perry. We just kind of mixed it up year after year. And Will and I are dear friends, man. I respect his artistry and I respect him as a man and our friendship. And we don't get a chance to tour nearly as much as we used to, but sometimes we'll wind up on the same jazz festivals and we try to play catch up you know, see how the families are doing and all that kind of stuff. So, yeah, that was a good run for me and Will.
But,
you know, as they say, good things come back around. So, who knows? There may be a chapter two. We'll see.
Hey, they tried bell bottoms.
Yeah, exactly.
We're going to take a little bit of a break right now, Gerald, so we can get a chance to play some of this music we're sharing with everybody. And we'll be right back, folks. This is No Excuses with my special guest, Gerald Albright. We'll be right back.
Ooh.
Hey folks, this is No Excuses. I'm your host, Rodney Arbona, and I'm here with my very special guest, Gerald Albright. And we were just talking about Will Downing in 1998 with The Pleasures of Night, and we're going to move on to 2002 with Groovology album. What a great name.
Well, thank you. You know, of my 18, soon to be 19 records, I always say that each record is a chapter of my life. And in 2002, when I made Groovology, when I listen to that record, it takes me right back to when I recorded it. And I was just in a very upbeat mood at that point. I love funk. I come from the world of James Brown and Philly International sound, the Motown sound. And, you know, all that stuff kind of came within that project and a few other projects that we could speak of. But Groovology, the song itself, which is a title track, is a very special song to me, which was co-written and co-produced by a dear friend of mine named Luther Mano Haynes. And we had just met then. He's a fine producer out of the Detroit area, and he does a lot of gospel projects and things now, but just a genius at what he does, fine keyboard player. And he brought this tune to me and as a rhythm track, and then I put the horns on it, and it was a wonderful marriage of some serious funk, man, and some orchestration. So very proud of that tune.
Yeah, absolutely. When someone brings something like that to you, do you get like tingles saying, wow, I can feel this is going to happen?
Yeah, with certain songs, you just go, okay, this is a hit. Or even if it's not going to be a single, you know it's going to be a good album. And that song got a lot of airplay. And one of my bucket list items is to do that. I would love to do that song with Power Power being the background horn section, and you know, do it live. It would be great. We'll be right back.
Yeah, great horn section.
Yes.
And then we move on to Kicking In 2004.
Yes. Kicking It Up?
Yep.
Yeah. Again, you know, it's just another evolution of, I like big sound. You know, I come from, you know, that Earth, Wind, and Fire just...
Absolutely. You
know, the music is right on top of the speaker. It's just thick. I love thickness and full productions. And so Kicking It Up, as well as a lot of my other projects, they come from that energy of just, you know, old school, you know, real horns in the background, flutes, real rhythm sections. You know, I do use the MIDI, the computer and all that, but I try to marry the MIDI in with the live musicians, because there's no music that's greater than the live musicians, because music breathes better with live musicians. And so Kicking It Up was one of those projects as well that we just had fun putting together, right?
Now, when you're putting all this together and you're sitting with everybody and you're getting that energy, is it like an out-of-body experience when you just feel that flow and it's just coming together so naturally?
It happens every now and then, that out-of-body thing. It doesn't happen consistently. There's certain recording sessions and even certain times on stage in a live performance where all the energies just kind of parallel. They just come together and they're just so cohesive. And you can feel it both in the music and then in the audience's reaction. Like, oh, shoot, man, something's getting ready to happen. and it's like, you know, getting happy in church, you know.
Yes.
I'm about to blow. and that's when it becomes an out-of-body experience, because, you know, now you're celebrating the music on the optimum level. And
right.
And sometimes, Rodney, to be honest, I've done a concert or I've done a recording session, and people will say, man, that was killing. And I would say, well, I don't even remember what I did. I can't tell you what I did. You know, so you know, it's on that level. And when you reach that level, that's like the apex of where you want to be, no doubt.
I've experienced it once playing sax. I switched over from trumpet, and my brother plays guitar, and it was like the first time we had no interruptions, just the two of us playing, and about 5 to 7 minutes into playing, all of a sudden, it was just, you said, I didn't feel my fingers, I didn't feel my lungs breathing, I felt like I was off the ground, and I was almost afraid I was going to fall on my rear end.
it really is a great moment, it really is, and you know, and it's hard to describe that to people who are just listeners. You know, you just, it's really hard to convey that spiritual energy, but at least they feel it when they hear it. And that's the bottom line. That's why we're there to do it.
That's true. And that rolled you right into 2008 with a Grammy of New Beginnings.
Oh, yeah, New Beginnings. Now New Beginnings is a real special record for me because that reflects my move from California to Colorado. We moved in 2005.
Okay.
And there was a newfound energy in being in Colorado. There was a freedom here. You know, you're directly with nature. I have pictures literally of, you know, I have big windows in my studio, and I have pictures of me working in the studio with my music blasting, and literally three or four deer are coming up to the window looking inside.
That's great.
You know, curious of what's going on. And when you have that type of aura or,
yes,
or ambiance, it's really conducive to enhancing the creativity of what you're trying to do at that given point in time. So New Beginnings is a reflection of that new move to Colorado and just a whole newfound energy. You know, we're starting anew. And when we moved to Colorado, we didn't know really anybody. We maybe knew a couple of people, but something as a family drew us to Colorado. And that was the next chapter for us. And now here it is, 2017. And, you know, we're still loving it here. It's home now.
That's great. I can completely understand. As a city boy, I live in the Pocono Mountains myself.
And nice.
There's times when bear walk through the yard, or deer, or turkey. There's who knows what's walking through next.
Yeah.
I understand because I do a lot of hiking up into the mountains, and I always tell people there's an energy in the mountains. The minerals that your body's absorbing, you can't get anywhere else. It's coming from the soil and digesting through your lungs. It just brings that whole, like you said, it's a whole other level of energy you can't find anywhere else. So I completely understand.
Well, I'm glad we're at one with that, because it's hard to tell people that, you know, and the move happened so quick in 05 that we didn't really have a chance to tell people that we were moving. I mean, you know, and all of a sudden we're in Denver, and now we're calling people saying, guess what, we moved to Colorado. And they're like, why did you move from great Los Angeles to Colorado? And we were asking this question, you know, like on a daily basis, and finally we just defaulted to, you guys just have to come and see.
That's right.
You know, so we're really enjoying it, and my wife and I talk about it all the time. It took her a minute to settle in because she's a city girl too. But after a few years, she said, "You know, babe, this is home." feeling good, you know. So
that's a great, it's beautiful being in harmony where you live.
Yeah, no doubt.
And that brought us into Sax for Stacks.
Yes. Now, this was a concept record that I did with Concord some years ago. They came to me and they said, well, you know, we own the archive of the Stax catalog.
Okay.
And what we'd like to do is get the cream of the crop tunes, pick them, and you do these wonderful arrangements. And, you know, and we'll call it Sax for Stax. And that's how that all came about. So now that was a grueling task for me to go through all the artists and Stax records and all the records that they did, and hundreds and thousands of records, you know, deduce it down to 10 songs or 11 songs, whatever it was on that project. And but I really loved that project for what it was. We recorded it at a place called Castle Oaks, which is in Calabasas, California, and that's one of my favorite studios. It has a real warm sound, and it's a very retro sound. It kind of takes you back to the albums, you know, back in the day, and it has that kind of warmth, that analog sound.
Yep.
And so that's what we went for on that project.
Analog has a special, let's say, heartbeat all on its own.
It really does. It really, really does. I go back and listen to a lot of the records that I did early on analog, and they're just so thick and so rich. I mean, you know, digital has its place, you know,
yes,
its place sonically too. I mean, I love the clarity, but there's something about that real warm thickness that analog brought that I really appreciated, and it was really evident on that Sax for Stax project.
Yeah, and analog gives you that opportunity just by changing the needle on the turntable, how it makes something sound different, brings it to another level.
It really does, absolutely.
We're going to take another little break right here, Gerald, because we're just pounding away with all this wonderful music, and I know people are itching to hear, so we're going to get a chance to let them hear that, folks. We'll be right back. This is No Excuses with my very special guest, Gerald Albright.
Go ahead, do your thing.
Just get out the way.
like you did when you first come here.
If you haven't been listening the last moment or so, this is No Excuses. I'm your host, Rodney Arbona. I am with the legendary Gerald Albright, and he's been so kind to share so much of his life and, of course, his accomplishments. But we're having more fun, I think, talking about all of his life and the deer walking around the house and how it all comes together.
Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. It's a beautiful thing.
Yes. Now, I understand you had a couple opportunities of appearing on television.
Yes, I've had my stint on TV with a few shows. I did the Byron Allen show. I was the guest artist on that show. People thought I was a musical director on that show because I got so much hammer time. But I was actually the guest artist on the Byron Allen show. And I did A Different World. I did Melrose Place. I did a lot of, I did American Idol. A lot of TV shows when I lived in Los Angeles. It was a fun process. TV is a whole nother thing from recording records or playing live, though. It's a whole nother animal.
Yes. Yeah, it really is.
It's
a tougher interaction playing to a tube, isn't it?
It is, and you know, everything is time oriented. You know, you got to do, you know, 15 seconds in and out of commercial, and the whole, everything is just so precise.
Yes.
And as a jazz musician, you know, jazz is kind of loose and free, and you know, it just kind of comes out
right
as it comes out. That's not what TV is. TV's like, you better get it done in 15 seconds or you're in trouble.
That's why when Glenna said to me she was giving me 15 minutes, I said, hold on a second here. Gerald and I are going to go way past 15 minutes.
Yeah, she's putting on the business hat, man.
Yes, so. She did, and rightfully so. Oh, that's great. Then we went on to Pushing the Envelope in June 2010.
Yeah, Pushing the Envelope is a very special record for me as well. You know, I tell you, the whole songwriting process, you know, when I get ready to start a record, I have to think of the blueprint, I have to think of the concept, and, you know, who I'm going to use in terms of musicians and vocalists and all that. Pushing the Envelope was a very easy record for me to put together. You know, you have certain records that take a good while to get out. Pushing the Envelope was one of those records that just kind of flowed out. And after it was over, it's like, okay, we're done. But the creative juices during that moment in 2010 was just at an optimum. It just, everything just flowed out. You know, it wasn't a thing where I would hit a creative lock or something and I had to go away and then come back. It just kind of flowed out. So I love that record.
So maybe the name could be changed to Lick in the Envelope because it was just so simple.
Yeah, they called it that.
Yeah.
writing and your creativity? Because everybody thinks it's real simple. We know it's not a simple thing. And of course, you're also depending on other people. How do you put this puzzle together, Gerald? Because like you just mentioned a great idea a moment ago. You just, when you were saying something comes to you and you got to bring all these other people together. Is it the cart before the horse all the time, or is the horse before the cart, or how's that work for you?
Well, early on, I used to have this method of doing records. You know, I would, I would do a demo tape. You know, that would be the blueprint, and then I would say, okay, this musician and that musician would sound great on this. This vocalist and that vocalist sound great. You know, I can play bass guitar on this, or I can play horn or flute. Or, you know, I'd start piecing together the puzzle. Nowadays, now that I'm 19 records in, I'm gonna say about halfway through those records, I just let the records evolve. I really don't put a lot of planning into it. I like to allow the creativity to really happen. And in order for that to happen, you just have to be objective and kind of stand back and say, okay, I gotta do another record. What is it feeling like? And you go within your inner self and you go, where am I in my life right now? I wanna be very genuine with my audience. What experiences have I learned up to now that I can put into this project that would be authentic and very genuine when people think about Gerald Albright? And so that's the way I do it. And I just flow with those energies that I've been given and those life lessons that I've been given, and I convert them into musical notes. And that's how I do it today, as opposed to being so rigid in terms of, okay, we have to do the record this way or that way.
That's beautiful.
It's a lot easier and it's a lot more genuine when I do it than the current way that I'm doing it.
That's beautiful. It's such a true expression of who you are.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
That's great. Man, so now we go into, we had 24/7 that you did with Norman Brown.
Yeah, Crazy Norman, Stormy Norman.
I hope he's not listening.
No, I'll call him crazy to his face. But it meant with love, though. No,
I know that.
Yeah, we're longtime friends, and we go all the way back to the 80s, early 90s, and definitely one of my favorite guitar players on the planet. And
yes,
it's really interesting. Like what always happens, we never see each other until we get in airports or we're at a jazz festival or something, and we have a chance to kind of catch up. And I saw him in the airport one year, probably the year prior to putting out 24/7, and we both said it at the same time, man, we got to do something together, we got to do a record together or something. And so I said, we need to do that. And so at the time, the managers got together and we found out a time slot in our busy schedule so we can really focus in on the project. And I produced half of the record, he produced the other half, and it really became a nice reflection of our friendship and our respect for one another as artists and as musicians. And I go back and listen to that record, and with all the touring that we've done based on that record, I just smile and say, man, that was a good chapter. That was a great experience.
Yeah, it's great. And you also did some updated versions of Tomorrow and Champagne Life on that.
Yes, and Champagne Life is like one of my anthems now. I play it in my own show, and that's like one of the party records of my show. People get up and dance, and Tomorrow was always one of my favorite songs, and Norman actually brought that idea to the table, and we put it together, and it just really came out great, man. That was a wonderful production for us.
Yeah, and it sure was, because you were nominated for a Grammy, so congrats.
Yeah, thank you very much. Thank
you. You're welcome. We're going to take another little break, Gerald. We've got to let these people hear this music, because I know they're just itching for it. Folks, thanks for listening. This is the show No Excuses. I'm your host, Rodney Arbona. I'm here with Gerald Albright. We'll be right back. Excuses Show. I'm your host, Rodney Arbona. I'm here with the legendary Gerald Albright, and we were just talking about his album 24/7 and how it was nominated for a Grammy and it was something special to you, which is fantastic to hear.
Yeah, very, very special. And, you know, I see Norman today, and we kid one another. He said, man, we gotta do 24/7 part two. We got to get back into it. So, who knows? It may happen, man. We'll see what happens. Yeah.
You know, take a step back, looking at your album titles. The titles have such meaning when you hear the music. You know, sometimes the titles are there and you have to figure it out when you're listening to the music that's in the title. But your titles, like you just said, are different chapters in your life, and they're very apropos of you the way you're sharing it with us as well.
Well, thank you. You know, I really like being honest with the music, Roddy, because I think that's when you're going to bring the best music out of yourself. You know, if you're given a God-given talent and you try to harness it with some pretentious elements, it never really works out the way it should. But if you're just honest with it and you just let it flow and bring people around you with good spirits and positive vibes, man, the music is just going to soar every time. And that's what I love about what we do.
And speaking of soaring, talk about everything we're just saying. We're going to go into talking about Slam Dunk. What a perfect name.
Oh, man. One of my favorite records, actually, Slam Dunk. This particular record, I got a chance to really show my love for the bass guitar.
Yes.
As well as the saxophone. It was a collaborative effort between me and a gentleman who I affectionately call Big Dog. His name is Chris Big Dog Davis.
Yes.
He's from Wallingford, Connecticut. One of the finest keyboard players and producers and songwriters that I've met in my time. In fact, he works consistently with my touring band. It's hard to leave home without him. You know, he has such a mainstay in my band. And so we collectively did this record, Slam Dunk, and we deemed it a slam dunk. We came approaching it as though, you know, we were going to hit the three-pointer every time, you know. And it was a very good record for us. Very, very good record.
And now, then, like you said, during that song, so let me just emphasize it, not only you played bass, you played every saxophone out there.
Yes. Yeah, well, as you can see, let me just pan over. As you can see, this is the family of saxophones here.
There we go.
From the baritone all the way up to the soprano. And as we were discussing earlier, Rodney, about, you know, having that influence of Earth, Wind & Fire, where you want all the horns that you can get on a track. I mean, that's just the way I hear the music. And so when we did Slam Dunk, you know, I wanted to pull all stops up because we really wanted to make a statement that, you know, the music can be timeless. The music can have those elements from way back in the day when you used to hear the Earth, Wind & Fire records and the old Tower Power and Wrecker Brothers, all that stuff. Real horns, real, you know, instrumentation, you know, the real authentic stuff. Mm-hmm. And that's my sound. And it's hard for me to detract from that because I just live and breathe that on a daily basis.
And not only you can do that, you also do some amazing cover songs. You've done some Phil Collins, James Brown. I mean, the list goes on and on with the cover songs that you do. And it's amazing. To me, I think you actually elevate the song and give it new meaning.
Well, thank you. I mean, every time I do a cover song, I try to, I never want to really copy what's already been done. That's already made history.
Right.
What I try to do is either take it to the next level or just, you know, do a nice, unique departure from the original. I see a lot of artists out there who basically try to make it a cookie cutter experience from the original song, but I try to take it to a different place so people can hear the freshness of the arrangement. And when I go back to songs of like Phil Collins and Luther Vandross
and Luther, yes,
yeah, it's you really want to pay homage to their creativity and try to take it to another level. And at the same time, it's a musical compliment to them that they're a part of my evolution. You know, I do a cover song because I like it, but I also do it because I'm really a fan of the artist or a series of artists who have done those songs. So it's kind of my way of saying thank you to them for their respective talent and genius.
Well, that's a very gentleman conversation right there, Gerald, because you playing somebody's music is something to another level every time I hear you play a cover song. And especially Luther, as I teased you when I met you, I asked you if you owned a candle company, because you and Luther Vandross cover songs, you should own a candle company, my friend.
Oh, thank you, man. I'll have to give it a thought.
We'll be right back. latest album, G.
Yes. This is probably the most special record that I've done. I mean, all of them are very special to me, but this is the point in my life, Rodney, where I said, okay, the way we're doing business in the record, you know, with record companies these days, is a lot different than what it used to be. You know, the business model for doing records is a total 180 now. You see a lot more independent artists on the front and doing very well. I decided 2 or 3 years ago that I was going to totally restructure my business model. And that's when I started my own record company. And I decided to take my career in my own hands. I'm proud to say, the product of that step out on faith. And it was truly a step out on faith because it was totally different from the way that I did business leading up to that point. And I'll be honest, it's very scary when you go, okay, I'm so used to doing, you know, business this way, and now I want to just totally flip it and do it a whole nother way. And so what I did, over the 30 years that I've been, you know, on the road and making records, I leveraged my fan base, and I said, well, okay, I'm going to step out on faith and do my own record with my own record company, and, you know, but promote it and posture myself as a major label. And the G record has been very, very successful, and I'm so happy that people have gravitated towards it and embraced it. I think my audience, and I can say this probably on behalf of other artists, they don't really care what the origin of the music is. They just want the music.
Yes.
You know, they don't care that it was recorded in a $300,000 or $400,000 studio or $1 million studio, or if it was just done on a small computer in someone's freaking bedroom. If it's the right song, if it's the right musical message, if it's authentic, if it's genuine, the audience is going to love it, regardless of how it got developed. You know,
so, absolutely. It is a great album. It's an absolute awesome album. And you're right. People can't tell.
I'm not near your level, but I've had my experience in music. Listening to it, as you've always done, is you sent out this message, and it's a great message. It's positive. You have a very positive vibe. Just listening to your music and speaking to you before, and the amount of time you and I've chatted through electronically, and now here, of course, this G album, I think, is going to take you and continue to help you progress on this level. I think I'm glad you stepped out.
Thank you. It feels good, and I have a freedom that I haven't witnessed before. You know, there were a lot of chiefs and not enough Indians in the equation before. Now I'm the CEO, and, you know, I pretty much call all the shots, and whatever happens, I'm responsible for making sure that every step of it, both business-wise, musically, and creatively, is at an optimum. And whether it succeeds or fails, I'll be the guy to handle it.
I don't think you need to worry about that. And speaking of one of the great songs, Frankie B.
Ah, yes. Frankie, Frankie B is a reflection of my dear friend Frankie Beverly. I am a huge Frankie Beverly and Maze fan from way back. And I'm fascinated with this group because we're speaking of a group that hasn't recorded a record in literally 2 decades plus. But they still tour, and they're filling stadiums and theaters and festivals like they did back in the day. That says something about the perpetual nature of music. You know, you really don't have to have a new record out in order for people to come. And but as long as the message is there, and there's been some wonderful positive messages through the Maze's music that I've loved throughout the years. And on the G project, I wanted to pay homage to the great Frankie Beverly. And I told him upon releasing the record that I wrote a personal tune for him, Frankie B. And since then, we've been keeping in touch on it, man, because I always keep him abreast of the chart action. You know, it went number one.
Yes.
On several charts. And, you know, I'll always send him a text message with a picture of the chart and his name and the whole thing. And you know, it's just a reflection of a great long-time friendship. And Rodney, I actually had the pleasure of touring with Maze. I opened some shows for Maze, and Frankie was very gracious for me to actually sit in with the band on a few occasions. And I was just a little kid at the candy store.
you know, Gerald, your energy, again, just like you just said with that other band, they haven't done something in two decades. It's all about the energy and the message. And your message is out there. And your energy is you're just such a great gentleman. And you can just feel your connectivity. Like I said, when I first met you, I felt like I'd known you for years because your energy is so open to and receptive. And you're just, it's nice feeling that humbleness, but you're just such a powerhouse of a musician.
Well, thank you. Thank you. And, you know, with that said, I cannot take all the credit for that. I had great parents. I have a great family around me on a daily basis, and they keep me structured and balanced and humble. I'm a God-fearing guy as well. So all of that played through the guy that you see on the screen here. I'm just genuine Gerald who just loves to play that saxophone and that bass and whatever else he decides to pick up and write that song every now and then that makes people smile.
I think we got another song, Genuine General Gerald.
Yeah, write that down.
You know, speaking of your name and your energy, I can't believe where the time went because I told you 15 minutes was not going to happen.
I'm looking at the clock and we're coming up on an hour. But it's
yeah, we are. And for me, it feels like 5 minutes and I'm watching the clock.
Yeah, but man, it's a testimony to how much fun we're having. And Rodney, I just have to say thank you for your continuous and optimum support of the music that we do. It's people like you that keep the message out there that we're still doing what we do, and as long as we have platforms like yours, we can do what we do. So thank you for that oneness and your energy. We appreciate it.
You're so welcome, and thank you as well. Gerald, I want to give you a moment because I want your audience to also get a chance to find you. Is it safe to say GeraldAlbright.com, your website, is the best portal for you?
Yes, well, you know, I'm easy to find. Yes, you can definitely go to the website, GeraldAlbright.com. G.A. Albright is my handle on Twitter. I have 4 or 5 Facebook pages out there. I'm on Facebook Messenger. So I'm easy to find, and I'm always very active and interactive on social media, doing email blasts of where I'm going to be and all that. For the musicians out there, if you have specific questions about the instruments I play or career-oriented type stuff, you know, I try to keep up with all of the questions that are asked as well. So feel free to reach out, and if I can touch you with a positive thought that will enhance your life, I'm happy to do that.
That's wonderful. Thank you for that, Gerald, my friend. I can't believe the hour is here upon us. I want to thank you once again so much for your time. This has been an absolute pleasure for me and something I'll always remember. And of course, I know we're doing this again because we can go for hours.
Yeah, no doubt about it, man. In this holiday season, that I just wish you happy holidays.
Thank you.
And a great 2018 to come.
Yes, God bless your family. Say hello to everybody. I feel a part of the family now that I spoke to all of them.
You're Rodney Albright now.
Yes, I am. Well, look, we got the same initial and last name.
Exactly.
I'm going to do Albright - Arbona.
I love it.
Have a great holiday, my friend. God bless you. I'll talk to you soon. Peace out, my brother.
Take care, brother. Take care.